G'day and welcome to Space Engineers tutorial number 2. This time we're going to cover a way you can go about upgrading your mining methods. If you followed the last tutorial, you would have spent a fair bit of time climbing down a hole to mine out minerals by hand. Now we're going to take those minerals and turn them into a more efficient atmospheric miner. Once the ores you've collected have been processed by the refinery, you can use your assembler to turn them into components. My approach to this sort of industry has always been to simply build excessive amounts of all the parts rather than spend effort working out precisely what I need. Maths is not my friend. So before I start any build, I queue up the components that I'm likely to need for the build. In the case of an atmospheric miner, you'll likely need a little of everything and a lot of motors. That's because all the atmospheric engines require lots of them. Don't forget, you're likely to use a lot of hydrogen for your personal jetpack, so make sure you've collected some ice to allow you to refuel. Before we get to the actual building, there is another thing to do that will help you make the build process easier. I find that having a couple of hydrogen tanks in your inventory can allow you to use your jetpack with impunity, which more than makes up for the loss of inventory space. To get these, go to an inventory access point on the lander and look for the oxygen generator. It will have a couple of hydrogen tanks in it that you can double-click on to transfer to your personal inventory. To refill them later, simply drag them back across to the oxygen generator, and if it has any ice left, it will refill your tanks for you. If you've watched any other guides of how to build small ships in Space Engineers, you'd see people placing a small landing gear. In previous versions, and sometimes in the current version, this is the easiest way to start a small ship. The landing gear automatically locks even when it's not fully constructed. However, since this has been intermittently breaking, I'm going to show you the way that's my preferred workaround for this problem. If you're parked anywhere but next to an ice lake, you probably won't have a flat surface to build on. So create a platform with light armor blocks. If the platform isn't level, press the B key to make sure the first block is level with the current natural gravity. Then extend out from there. An area 6x6, 8x8 should be comfortably large enough. If you are tight on iron, you don't need to complete all the blocks. I've only done that to help the contrast of the construction. Let's set up our menu bars with all the blocks the new ship will need. To set up a toolbar, press Ctrl then the number of the toolbar you want to use. I'm going to select 2 and 3. Add the important components to the toolbar, such as cockpit, atmospheric thrusters, reactors, batteries, gyroscopes, cargo container, etc, etc. If one toolbar is not enough for the parts you need, put them onto the next one. And now, for starting your ship. Press the number for your light armor blocks until your cursor changes to a small block. Put this down somewhere near the middle of the platform. Extend out from two sides until you have 12, 15 in a row, and extend out from either end until you form a large H or I, depending on your perspective. This should provide enough stability for you to build your ship above it without it tipping over. From the middle, raise a line of blocks 5, 6 or so high. Now you're ready to start placing the actual ship blocks. These lengths and heights that I've suggested are based on experience, not maths, and roughly how big this ship's going to end up being, so you'll adjust these as you need. The build order I use is not set in stone. I would encourage you to experiment with lots of different approaches. This one is just enough to get you going and hopefully prevent some of the early frustration with designs not working. Place down a small industrial cockpit, attach a drill directly to the front. There is a small conveyor port on the center of the industrial cockpit front that will match up to one at the rear of the drill. Since just one drill is never enough, we can then attach a drill directly to each side of the center drill. Again, this matches the ports up nicely. Since we're on a planet with an oxygen-rich atmosphere, we don't need to have an oxygen generator, but we do need a way to push air into the sealed cockpit. Since we're not connecting an oxygen generator to the back of the cockpit, this allows us to place some conveyors, reactors, and gyroscope into this space while also setting things up nicely for a medium cargo container to be connected behind. Make sure you build as you go, as some of these blocks won't be accessible later. Now that we've got a conveyor connection point in the center, we can match this up to the medium cargo container. This plus the drill's own capacity will be more than adequate for our first miner and mean that we won't need an enormous number of engines for lift. My preferred alignment is to have the cargo container so that a large connection is facing downwards. Then you can place a connector on this, which will nicely match up to the docking port of a station. The top side of the cargo container can be a reasonable spot for us to place a battery, and an ore detector can be placed behind it. With that, we've got all the core components of the ship, minus the ability to fly. For thrusters, there are two approaches that I consider. The first is using a large thruster to provide lift, and the second is just slapping 1,000 small thrusters on the ship to try and give as much lift, but without the same shape constraints. For the first build, placing a single large thruster will pretty much guarantee that the ship will work, so we'll go with that plan. Place your large thruster to provide lift. It is relatively convenient to have it at the rear, then place multiple small thrusters in all other cardinal directions. You may even want to place some for down thrust and keep them turned off until you need them. The common situation I find them useful is when I accidentally flip my ship while mining, and the gyroscopes aren't powerful enough to right the ship. A little extra boost from those downward thrusting engines can make all the difference to your recovery. Mining shafts tend to be pretty dark, so let's put some lights on the ship so we're still able to see what we're about to run into. Once all those parts are built, grab some uranium from your lander and place it in the cargo hold of the mining ship. If it doesn't evenly distribute between your reactors, you may have to give it a helping hand. This will only work in this particular situation because you've already got a battery on the ship, and that's providing power for the conveyors to handle the uranium from the connector to the reactors. If you don't have another source of power, you'll need to attach a temporary reactor to provide power for this to work. Sadly, these reactors will never be able to put out enough power to keep the ship flying, but they will slowly recharge your ship whenever you land and turn off your thrusters. So if you're out mining and don't realise how low your energy got, simply land, apply some patience, and recharge from your onboard reactors. Later on, you'll be able to build a station to connect the small ship to and recharge its battery from the station's power grid, saving a lot of time on the recharge. Now that your ship's complete, we can remove the support base from underneath it and make sure that your engines are on before doing this. You don't want to crash into the ground. And we're good to go. My preferred way to set up the ship for drilling is to group the three drills together and then set them to G menu options on your toolbar for the ship. Have a general one so that you can left or right click, and then also one where you can just switch it on and off. This can be really useful when you get down to a large deposit, so you can just keep going back and forth without having to press any keys whatsoever. Or maybe I'm just lazy. My usual approach to mining with a ship like this is to bore a little vertical shaft down to the minerals, preferably something wide enough to take the ship horizontally with space to spare. This takes a little bit of extra effort at the start, but I find it's worth it for the ease of the return trip and the lack of replacement parts you require from all the damage you get hitting stuff on your way back up. Whenever you're mining, keep an eye on the total mass of your ship and your ability to thrust upwards. Finding the maximum load requires mathematics, which I've previously stated I'm too lazy for, or simply do what I do and use a little bit of trial and error. If you're finding your ship won't go up, land as gently as you can and manually ditch some of the contents by putting it into your suit inventory and then dropping it. I like to leave a fair bit of buffer between how much I fill up and the maximum capacity so that my flight home doesn't take hours and so that the landing can be a little safer. Well, there you have it, your first atmospheric mining ship. I hope this tutorial was helpful. The next one, show you how to make this little mining ship a little bit more effective, particularly on planets where you end up with an enormous excess of stone. See you then.